Hey, Father, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to come to your house this morning. Lord, thank you for the many blessings you provided throughout the week, Lord. We ask that you would use today to refresh our hearts, motivate us as we go into the next week, Lord. Lord, I ask that you be with the many prayer requests mentioned. Lord, you know each one by their individual needs, Lord. I ask that you would touch them as only you can. Lord, I ask that you would use this offering to get your work done, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
My tribute to God be the glory. How can I say thanks for the things you have done for me? Things so undeserved, yet you give to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, I owe it all to God.
I say thanks. Now we're going to say, how great thou art. Let's sing that together. Thank you.
She brought you oil, the purest gift she had, and you washed her soul with her tears. Though more than 1,000 years have passed, I still weep at how much that woman's just like me, and how much I want to be at your feet, where I feel your spirit cover me. Darkest of my sins, they are forgiven. What would you ask of me? I'd give up everything just so I can be at your feet. And I'll see that glorious mansion on high, but I'll be content just to see your face if I can just find my place at your feet, where I feel your spirit cover me. Darkest of my sins, they are forgiven. What would you ask of me? I'd give up everything just so I can be at your feet.
Thank you, Cindy, for that message and song this morning. And leads us right into our thought from the Word of God this morning. If you would, turn with me in the Bible to Proverbs chapter 30. Proverbs chapter 30 this morning. If you don't have a Bible, we've got one for you there in the pew. We encourage you to take that and turn with us to Proverbs 30. That can be found on page 586 in the Pew Bible. Page 586 in the Pew Bible, Proverbs 30. Thank you again, Cindy, for sharing that song with us today, and as it puts our hearts and minds toward our Lord and the refuge that we find in Him, as we're going to talk a little bit about that this morning. I got a comment on, Mike was talking earlier about a bad joke battle, and who would win that. And I think that, you know, really comes down to what's the objective of a bad joke battle. If it's to genuinely tell a bad joke, I think I've got him. If it's to make you laugh, that's a toss-up. That could be fun. We might have to try that sometime. I think we would have to bring in extra chairs, though. I think we'd have a sellout crowd for that one, a bad joke battle. Well, I've been enjoying summer, the sunshine, beautiful weather we've had lately. I hope you have, too. we were talking about it this week, and Jamie said, you know, it's just a matter of time, and it's going to be dark at 6 o'clock. And I said, stop talking like that. That's not nice. We don't want to talk like that. But I love summer. I love the extra light, the warmth, the ability to be outside and enjoy it. Mark was talking about on his vacation there, and just being able to be out and enjoying what God has done. And you know, there's a lot that we can learn from God's creation. We've been talking on Sunday mornings, this will be the last one actually, because we're at the last week in July, on the subject, insignificant, how little things matter. Insignificant, how the little things matter. And you know, in creation, there's a lot of little things. Things that, you know, we would overlook really on a regular basis. So small that we don't even really pay attention to them. Because they're small, they seem insignificant. But in creation, God has made some small things that can teach us incredibly big lessons. And so this morning, we're actually going to look at something here in the book of Proverbs, chapter 30. Four little creatures. The Bible calls them little, small, tiny, seemingly insignificant creatures, but that we can learn some big lessons from. And we're going to see that in just a minute. You know, I've heard this before. Someone said, people come into your life for a reason, a season, or a lifetime. You know, God allows people and things to come into our life, sometimes just to teach us something, sometimes to remind us of something or to intersect us for whatever reason. Sometimes people come into our life for a season, maybe of teaching, learning, help, and then a lifetime. But as we consider the people and the things that God has given us in this world, sometimes we overlook the small things. And this morning I want to direct our attention to some of those. Now, have you ever learned a lesson from an animal? And your children don't count as animals, okay? Have you ever learned a lesson from an animal? Well, of course, if we watch and we pay attention, animals can teach us some things. Now, most of you know I have a little dog, Hanky Boy, a little Yorkie Poo guy, and I've learned a couple things from Hank. I've learned some lessons from Hank. Two things in particular. Number one, and this is kind of sentimental and it'll touch your heartstrings, but always get excited when your family comes through the door. Because, folks, there's coming a day when they'll either come through a lot less frequent or not at all. And I don't know if your dog's the same way, but when we come home, Hanky Boy is ready to jump out of his skin. He's excited. He shivers. He's jumping up and down. He just can't wait till we get in the door. And it's always a wonderful greeting when you come home to your dog and he's excited to see you. And so it reminds me that when my family comes home, that I should shake and jump up and, no, I'm kidding. But that I should be excited and glad to see my family come home. The other thing that Hank's taught me that's a little bit less important but nonetheless is fun is always enjoy food, right? Always enjoy food. I'm telling you what, when he knows I'm going to grill, it's a good day, okay? He gets excited, and when he sees me get the grilling stuff, he goes by the door, and he's, you know, waiting to get out there and to see what we're going to put on the grill, because usually Hank gets a little bit of whatever we put on the grill. So it's good. It's good to be excited about food, and especially good food. And so those are some of the funny types of things, but, you know, serious things you can learn from smaller creatures that God has put in our world. Now, he's provided some lessons for us from these small things, seemingly insignificant creatures. And I wonder, have we considered the lessons that God has given us in this world, even from small, insignificant sources? Let's take a look at the Word today. Proverbs chapter 30, okay? And we're going to look at verses 24 through 28. Proverbs 30, 24 through 28. It says, there be four things which are little upon the earth, but they are exceeding wise. The ants are a people not strong, yet they prepare their meat in the summer. The conies are but a feeble folk, yet they make their houses in the rocks. The locusts have no king, yet go they forth, all of them by bands. The spider taketh hold with her hands and is in king's palaces. Four little things, but that are exceeding wise. All right, let's pray this morning before we dive in. Our Father, we thank you for this time together, Lord, and we thank you for the music that we've sung already and that we've heard, and Lord, how it has turned our hearts' attention to you and your goodness, Lord, your greatness. And Lord, how the best place for us to be is certainly with you at your feet, to learn from you, and Lord, to just be loved by you. And Lord, now as we come to the Holy Word, I ask that you would help all of us to pay attention with our minds and our hearts, that we would listen on purpose. Lord, and as your Spirit speaks to us, I ask you that you would help us to put down our defenses, and Lord, that we would be obedient to whatever he says to us today. Lord, I ask that if there's somebody here today that doesn't know Jesus as their Savior yet, that they'll be saved today. And Lord, for those who do know Christ as their Savior, I ask that you'll help us to learn from these little creatures, Lord, the lessons that you have for us. And we ask these things in Jesus' name, amen. So four little things, it says there in verse 24, that are exceeding wise. What can we learn from these little things? Well, first of all, it starts off in verse 25 with ants. Ants, right? Little insignificant ants. As a child, I remember playing on the front porch and playing cars or whatever, and you'd see ants go by, and you wouldn't think too much of it. As an adult, you know, you go to a picnic and you see ants, and you think a lot of it. Ants are tiny. They're little creatures. Now, the Bible says here that they're not a strong people. Now, at first glance, we might look at that and say, now, time out. For their size, ants are pretty strong, aren't they? I mean, they can carry things, you know, tens of times worth of their weight. You know, they're a strong animal, really, for their size. But let's not get too caught up in that. When you compare an ant to the strength of the rest of the animal kingdom, things like they're not going to chase down an antelope like a lion might, you know. They're not going to constrict and swallow a rodent like a python might. They're not going to stun and then eat a seal like a great white shark might. And shameless plug, Shark Week starts tonight at 8 o'clock on Discovery, so I'm excited about that. One of my favorite weeks of the year. I get so excited about Shark Week. If you want to know what I'm doing in the evenings, that's what I'll be doing, watching shark video, okay? But when it says that ants aren't strong, it's really just saying that when you compare it to the stronger beasts of this world, they seem completely insignificant and tiny. But you know what this does say about ants? Their wisdom is that they teach us a lesson, number one, in preparation. They teach us how to prepare. We can learn a lot from an ant in this way. You know, ants understand something about preparation. They know that winter is coming. They know that there may be a time when food isn't as plenteous or when resources aren't as right at the hand there. They know that they need to prepare ahead of time for dire times ahead. So ants prepare. They'll gather and they'll go and they'll get sustenance and they'll bring it in and kind of have it there as a preparation. While it's available, they'll store it up. I've heard it said this: time is never wasted in preparation. Time is never wasted in preparation. And when we think about preparation, we think of the word prudence. You know what prudence does? Prudence teaches us to look ahead at possible rewards or consequences of activity or inactivity. Prudence makes us look ahead and say, okay, what are the rewards or consequences if I do or do not do fill in the blank? And ants teach us all about looking ahead, preparation. I wonder this morning, are you prepared? All right, prepared for what? Well, there's a lot of things to prepare for. As a younger person, I remember folks pulling me aside and saying, you need to prepare for your future and you need to financially get yourself set up and save money and put it in the funds and all these things and preparing for, you know, days far ahead. preparing for marriage, right? You would make sure that you had all your ducks in a row as far as having all your finances ready and having a place to live. And how about preparing for a child, right? That first child and getting the room together and painted and getting the crib put together and all the things ready for that baby when it comes home. Preparation. The ants teach us something about it. So there's a lot of things in life that we know that we need to prepare for, and it's good to be prepared, but what about not just this life? What about the life to come? That every one of us someday is going to leave this life and go into the next. Are you prepared? You know, James chapter 4 and verse 14 says, whereas you know not what shall be on the morrow. What is your life? It's a vapor, he says. It's a vapor. It's here, and then in just a moment, it disappears. You've all seen a vapor of smoke or of steam. You get a hot cup of coffee, the steam rises a few inches from the cup, and then it's gone. It's there for a moment, and it disappears. You know, that's really what our life is like. Our life here on earth is momentarily in the grand scheme of things. And so are we prepared for the life to come? You and I are not promised tomorrow. The Bible tells us, do not boast about tomorrow because you have no idea what a day is going to bring forth. Don't brag about what you're going to do or not do tomorrow. We don't know what will happen tomorrow. We don't know what will happen in 15 minutes from now. But we do know this. God gives us an opportunity now to be prepared for our eternal future. Aren't you glad that even despite the fact that we're sinners and that if we remain in the state that we were born in, that, yeah, the Bible says the real consequences of that is a place called hell. Aren't you glad that God didn't leave it that way and that we have no hope? You know, God sent His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to die on the cross. Jesus came to this earth and lived a perfect, sinless life that you and I have not done. He's the only man to ever do it. He lived perfectly, and because of His perfect life, He is able to be the sacrifice for our sins. And so Jesus did that. He died in our place, took our wrath from God upon our sin, took it upon Him, and the Bible says that if we repent, change our mind, and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that we'll be saved. Aren't you thankful for that? Today, did you know that you could know Jesus as your Savior and know that your eternity is secure? Did you know that you could put your faith in Jesus right now where you're at? Sitting there in your pew, you could call out to Him right now, Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner, and I believe that You came to this earth and You died on the cross for my sins, and that You were buried, and thankfully You rose from the dead 3 days later. And so, Lord Jesus, I ask You to save my soul. Would You save me? Do you know if you ask Jesus to save you today, He will? You can prepare today for your eternity. Would you? Would you trust Christ today? You know, the ants, that small little creature, teach us to be prepared. I hope the next time you see an ant, you'll think about your eternity. I hope the next time that you see a little ant somewhere that you'll think, am I prepared for my eternity? Trust Christ today. Well, the second little creature here in this list is found in verse number 26. It says, the conies are but a feeble folk, yet they make their houses in the rocks. The conies, what in the world is a coney? Well, in Cincinnati, right? A coney is glorious, okay? It is not what the Bible means by conies. Now it's 11:30, so it's technically lunchtime. So let's take a minute and think about cheese conies, all right? And as I've grown older, a little bit of onion in there is great, you know, and a little bit of mustard. Man, it just, conies, right? All right, now let's get back to spiritual matters. These conies are completely different. What in the world is a coney, all right? Well, it's kind of like a rabbit or a rock badger is really a better word for it. It's a tiny little creature that kind of, it can't burrow, it can't climb, it can't build. It's kind of really a helpless little thing. And so the Bible says you got these conies, they're a feeble folk, feeble meaning they're pretty vulnerable. Their defenses, they don't really have much defense, so what do? They can't burrow, they can't build, they can't climb. Well, they realize their limitations. Here's the great thing about conies, they know they can't do those things. You don't see them trying to build burrow or climb. So what do? Look at verse 26. Yet they make their houses in the rocks. And they teach us a lesson number two in trust. Trust. They know their limitations, and they know where to find shelter. And so they trust it. They don't try to build. They can't. They don't try to scheme. They can't. They're incapable of it. So they find their refuge, their shelter, in a rock or among the rocks. They're not out picking a fight. They're not out defending their fortress. They don't have one. They're not scheming. They just go find the rocks and take shelter. What a lesson for us. You know, we need to be like the conies here, the rock badgers, and we need to realize our limitations. You understand there's only a certain amount of things that you and I can do in this life. We talked Wednesday night about a spiritual checkup and how when we listen to our lungs, we listen for breath, and that it reminds us that our breath is a gift from God. You and I someday are going to take our final one, and it'll be ordained by God. He's in control of all of it. And so when you think about God and us and creation and us, we are a feeble folk. Our life, the Bible says, my times are in thy hands, the Bible says. My life is in his hands. My times, he knows them. And so I am a feeble individual, a feeble creature. So what do? To defend myself. Well, you and I, we try to build spiritual shelters, if you will, and we wall the world out, and we wall even people who want to help us and love us out. We put up walls because we've been hurt. So we try to build these spiritual shelters. And sometimes if we can't build a shelter, we'll try to dig deep spiritually and just hide out of everything. And we'll dig ourselves down to where we get away from everyone and everything and have no contact. And that's not good for us either. And sometimes we try to climb above all of our troubles. When we have a trouble, we try to fix our way out of it or work our way out of it. We try to scheme and figure it all out because we can. Well, listen, we are feeble folk. And there's coming a day. Listen, unfortunately, the bank account may become empty, zero, bankrupt. The health may be bankrupt. Our relationships may be zero. And we're going to get down to where we find out we are a feeble folk. So what do? Well, learn from the conies. Take shelter in the rock. Mike Graver taught a great lesson on this weeks ago on a Wednesday night about sheltering in the rock. I'll give you a few Bible verses that tell us about this. 2 Samuel 22:3 says, "The God of my rock, in him will I trust. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my high tower and my refuge, my Savior. Thou savest me from violence." Friends, sometimes we get down to it, all we have left is God, our rock. Shelter in his cover. Psalm 18:2 says, "The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my buckler," that's a shield, "and the horn of my salvation and my high tower." You see, the psalmist knew God in this way. David knew God in this way. He knew God as his protector. He knew God as where he would take refuge. Psalm 94:22, this one says it best, I think, "But the Lord is my defense, and my God is the rock of my refuge." And Jesus said, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls." Listen, God is our rock. He is where we can take shelter from all that this world can throw at us. and this world will throw a bunch at us. In this life, Jesus said, you will have tribulation. So what do? Well, whatever is battering you, go to the rock. Go to Jesus. Whatever is chasing you today, run to Jesus. Whatever is threatening you today, hide in Jesus. Whatever is intimidating you today, oh, go to the rock. Find your Lord and take refuge in Him. Cling to the Lord in your time of trouble and distress and tribulation. He's there for you. You say, well, you don't understand, Pastor. It's been a long time since I've prayed or talked to God. Here's the good news. He hasn't gone anywhere. He isn't going to walk away from you. He said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He said that. So He's not walked away. You say, well, I don't even know how to go back to Him. Here's how you go back to Him. Father. Dad. Run to your Father. Run to your Father. He's there watching. He is waiting. And in those moments when nobody else can get it, when there's no fix, there's no cure, there's no recovery, go to the rock. What a lesson we can learn from these conies, these small, tiny, defenseless creatures. Well, the third little creature that we learn from here is in verse 27, the locusts. They have no king, yet go they forth all of them by bands, the locusts. I think of locusts, and those are some ugly mugs. They kind of remind me of cicadas, which I'm really excited about next year coming. I guess it was 18 years ago they were here. And I remember trying to mow my grass. You know how they're attracted to noise. And just dive bomb you. These things from the pit of, you know, Hades. They're wicked, they have red eyes, they make this weird noise. And even when they fly at you, they're screaming at you, you know. It's like, it's out of a horror movie. And there's thousands of them, you know. And I remember I was cutting my grass, I had a ball cap on, I put a towel under my ball cap so it would shield my neck. Because you know how those stupid things crawl over the back of you and you don't know they're there. And I had a wiffle ball bat because I didn't have a badminton racket. And I was mowing my grass ready. Now this year I'll have a badminton racket. I'm going to be prepared next year. But those things are wicked and horrible. And, you know, locusts, they damage crops and things. But the Bible says there's something we can learn from a locust. What can we learn from them? Well, here's what we can learn. Teamwork. Number three, teamwork. It says they don't have a king. They don't have a person out leading. They don't have a captain. They don't have a, like ants, you know, they don't have a queen. They just all kind of figure out that if we work together, things go smoother. And if we don't work together, then things go pretty bad for us. So the Bible says they don't have a king, they don't have a captain, they don't have a leader, but they figured out that they just go together and work together. They teach us about teamwork and cooperation. No visible leader, right? They don't have one, yet they work together. They actually cooperate without someone making them, is the point here. They've just kind of figured out it's better if we just work together. They understand that working together, and as we work together, much can be accomplished. As we cooperate, listen to this, everyone's needs can be attended to. What a thought, right? We're also concerned about having our needs met, and I have found in my short span of life, and I'm still learning this because sometimes I get selfish, that you know what? When I take care of other people's needs, guess what happens? God finds a way to take care of mine. It's a lesson that we can learn from these little creatures, locusts. Cooperation. Galatians 5:13 says, by love, serve one another. What a thought. You know? By love, serve one another. And I understand we have a lot of fears in this life. Our fear is that somehow we're going to be left out or forgotten. That's a fear that everybody has to some degree. It really is. No matter who you are, no matter how confident you are, how many people that you have surrounding you, all of us have some kind of fear inside of us that we're going to be forgotten or left out. It's just natural. It's nature for us to feel this way. And the Bible says one lesson we can learn here is that if we all look out for each other and we cooperate and serve each other, then everybody's needs will be met. We'll all be attended to. By love, serve one another. There should not be a spirit of competition among God's people. There shouldn't be. In a church family, there should be no competition among ministries. It's not right. I mean, we're all working for the same purpose. And let me say this. Among God's people corporately, globally, there should be no competition. Work together. Serve the Lord together. By love, serve one another. Great things can be accomplished with cooperation. And we learn this lesson from something as weird and small as a locust. 1 Corinthians 3:3, Paul wrote this to a very sick church. Listen to what he wrote. For ye are yet carnal. Carnal is not good. That means fleshly. You're not spiritually minded. All you think about is yourself. Ye are yet carnal. For whereas there is among you envying, y'all envy each other, and strife, that means fighting, and divisions, you break up and separate in corners. He says, are you not carnal? Are you not fleshly? There's not a spiritual bone in your body, Paul says. All you think about is you. And what does that cause? Divisions. What do divisions cause? Fighting and strife and envying. And I'll tell you what else it caused. It caused a lot of detriment to the cause of Jesus Christ. And so look, work together for the gospel. Philippians 1:27 says, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Work together, cooperation. There should be a spirit of cooperation. You say, well, I don't like how brother so-and-so does this. Okay. Is he serving the Lord? Is he doing his best to try to help? Yes, okay. Well, I don't like how sister so-and-so says this. Okay, well, is she trying to serve the Lord? Is she doing her best? Let it go. Cooperate. You see that we're all on the same team. You see that the goal here is all that people out there will know Jesus. That's all of our goal, cooperation. You know, unlike the locust, we do have a king. To the world, he's not visible. But to us, he is very visible. And so we are to cooperate together as he leads. And fourth and finally, the fourth little creature here is the spider, verse 28. The spider taketh hold with her hands and is in kings' palaces. So I guess the way I termed this is number four, holding on. Holding on. Spider takes hold with her hands and is in king. Holding on. So even something small like a spider, gross as they are and creepy as they are, they find their ways even into a king's palace. You know, you can defend your palace from big animals. It's pretty easy to see them and put doors and gates up and walls. But it doesn't matter how many screens you have, how many doors and windows you have, somehow a stinking spider is going to find its way in. And they're determined. They hold on. They take a hold of what they can do and they do it. They just get involved. It sets up a web and just lives. They don't mind if they do. And they teach us a lesson twofold. Number one is holding on to the promises of God. Holding on to the promises of God. Taking their hands, see what it says in 28? Taketh hold with her hands and is in the king's palace. Holding on to God's promises. 2 Corinthians 1:20 says, for all the promises of God in him are yea, and in him amen, unto the glory of God by us. In other words, all of God's promises have been fulfilled in Jesus. With a resounding yes. All of God's promises have been fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And Peter said that we have exceeding great and precious promises from God. And so we can hold on to the promises that God has given us. God has given us many great and precious promises. And that if you call upon the name of the Lord, you shall be saved. He promised that if you trust Christ as your Savior, that He and God will have you in the palm of their hand. And the Bible says no man is able to pluck you out. Once you're saved, you're there forever. He promises that He will never leave us or forsake us. We're never going to walk away from us. He promises that He gave us His Spirit to guide us in this life. He promises us a home in heaven when we do die. He promises that there'll never be a moment for the rest of our existence that will be without Him. These are all great and precious promises. And brothers and sisters, we need to take hold of those promises. Know them, believe them, and let them change our lives. When we have an occasion to doubt whether or not God will really come through, hold on to the promise. When you have an occasion to fear or doubt that God has walked away or does not know where you are, hold on to the fact that He is right there with you. These are the promises to hold on to. In that same verse, it talks about how the spider is in kings' palaces. And I couldn't help but to be reminded of that the Bible tells you and me to go boldly into the throne room, doesn't it? You see, the spider just goes boldly in there. It doesn't know that it shouldn't, you know? Look, the spider doesn't understand whether it's in a king's palace or in a shack, you know, a shed or a barn. It has no idea. It's just looking for somewhere to go and be taken care of. And so it just goes on in and sets up a web. Boldly, if you will. It doesn't know any better. It doesn't know that it shouldn't. If a spider doesn't knock on the door of the castle and say, "Excuse me, is this a king's palace?" "Well, yes, it is. Okay, I'll go down the street to somebody who's a little less well off." No. Spider doesn't know. It just goes right on in and sets up shop. Look, the Bible tells you and I, in Hebrews 4:16, that we should come boldly unto the throne of grace, where we can obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Just go on in. Listen, it should be a prayer for me and you should be that we don't know that we shouldn't do it. Not that we have to actually think about it. We just do it. We go right into the throne room and set up shop. "Lord, I'm here. I'm in the throne room. I'm in the palace." Of course I am. It's just what I do. Or do we? Or do we? And I cannot believe how often that we neglect being with God in prayer. How much peace we often forfeit. And the needless shame that we carry around. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Those words are more than a hymn. Aren't they so true? Aren't they so poignant? Aren't they so very relatable? Oh, what peace I often forfeit. I give it up. I give up peace because I don't go into the king's palace. I give up peace because I don't just walk into the throne room. If you're looking for peace today, just walk right in. The spider teaches us, you don't have to worry about it. Just go on in. Set up shop. I hope the next time you think of a spider, you see one. First of all, before you smash it. Or before you scream and tell somebody else to smash it. Pause and think about prayer. Pause and think about the precious promises and take hold of them. Walk right into the throne room. Stop carrying around the shame. He already took care of it. Walk right in. "Here it is, Lord." We should not hesitate. The spider doesn't. And nor should we. So where are you today? These four little creatures, right? Kind of things we don't think about unless they present themselves. But man, can we learn? Can we learn? God has given us these lessons this morning so He can guide us. And as He brings these to our heart's attention, may we learn from these little creatures. if you'd stand with me, please, and our musicians would come. We'll have a time of what we call an invitation. An invitation is exactly what it sounds like. You are invited to respond to God. Okay? What has God said to you today? Think about it. As you sat there this morning, whether it was the ant in preparation, are you prepared for your eternity? Maybe God reached into your heart this morning and said, hey, you're not quite prepared. Would you trust Him today? Would you trust Jesus as your Savior right now where you're at? You're just right where you're at. You can bow your head and whisper a prayer to Him. Just say, Lord Jesus, I know. I know I'm a sinner. I have broken your rules, and I ask, Lord Jesus, that you would save me. I believe that you died on the cross for my sins. I believe that you rose from the dead, and I'm trusting you. I give up. I'm trusting you, Lord Jesus. Would you ask Him today, right where you're at? Prepare. Maybe it's from the rock badgers, the conies, and the lesson that they teach us about our vulnerabilities. Are you vulnerable today? As the world seems like it's just crashing in, circumstances, heartaches, troubles, trials, you are just completely overwhelmed. You can't dig deep enough. You can't climb high enough. You can't build strong enough, but you don't have to. Run to Jesus. Maybe you're like the locusts today, and God spoke to your heart about, look, cooperate with your brothers and sisters. Work together for the gospel. And as we consider finally, as God spoke to our hearts this morning and we considered the ant and the coney and the locust and then the spider, is there a time, have you neglected the prayers? Have you neglected the palace? Go on in. Go on in right now. Right now, go on in. Talk to Him. Talk to Him this morning. Our folks are going to sing, and as they sing, you do business with God.